to get your rations.
They usually issue enough rations for 3 days.
Okay. 3 or 4, yeah.
So, right, they have 1 piece. Yeah. But when all four, she said that she as well.
Are you taking the consideration of crackers?
Yeah, 4 cup coffee,
4 cup of
sugar, salt.
Never got pepper, you had to buy that. Vinegar, whatever came to the army. Sometimes fresh vegetables came, but they would subdivide that up and give it to like you say. Go and steal or borrow or buy from farmers or settlers who follow the army to sell pies and cakes. They always said that those were always filled with indescribable objects.
Who knows?
Who went though? It was a very bland diet. Everybody ate different. Everybody prepared their stuff. No set way or no instructions how you cook your meals. So everybody just kind of invented things as they went along. One of the most popular, I guess, dishes is something called skilligalee. Slice up your pork or bacon, fry it in a pan, crumble up hardtack, a little bit of water, put that in there, so it's all in a big mush mess. And if you're really hungry, it's pretty filling. It is. It's not bad. It's not something I'd want to eat. What we're going to do at this moment is show you how the Army issued its normal rations. It was a way of supposedly giving the men fair rations without being prejudiced as to who might have a higher or meatier piece of meat or whatever. It goes back, there are references to this form being used in the French and Indian War, again, from the 1730s.
You ready?
I am one.
You going to clean them out?
Nope. I am. Antiscorbutic, and what that means is it hopefully prevents you from having scurvy. When you look at this, correct, you look at this, salty, starchy, bland diet with generally the lack of any fresh vegetables or fruit of any kind. There's a recipe for scurvy. The vinegar was supposed to, and again, it can be easily transported without spoilage. That's what you're looking at. Objects which cannot generally spoil when they're being transported. However, if you're getting, and hardtacks came in 50-pound boxes, there are photographs of these things stacked up at railheads that are stories high. Well, the first rain you get in Virginia is going to soak some of that. These aren't, hermetically sealed in plastic or tin foil or anything. And, of course, flour and wetness equals mold and goo and all kinds of fusty stuff. What do you do with it that time? Sometimes the soldier even ate it in that condition. There was no alternative. Sometimes they would make without a formal ceremony at it because sometimes the soldier
not being grinded properly. When the head of the barrel that came in was cracked open, it would be swimming with maggots. So the only thing to do is they would have a mock funeral, literally marching it to the edge of the calf, digging the hole, and burying it because there's nothing else to do. Fresh.
I don't have any soup.
Harry Sabers. Return. Sabers.
Yeah, come on.
Lon's going to do most of the talking.
Yeah, right.
Come on, Louise. We're going to talk to people. Let's do it in the shade. We only look stupid. Easy. Any questions? Anyone
nice
want to join?
Nice horse.
Pardon?
Nice horse.
Oh, yeah, she's a witch. but she's my worst. She's my worst.
Yeah.
We have a very unique relationship. I tell her what to do, just like my wife, and she don't do it. Any questions? Anybody? Nobody? Well, I'll tell you a little bit about the tack we use. This is all reproduction gear. It is made to look exactly like what was used during the Civil War. The saddle is an 1859 McClellan. It's not a very pretty saddle, but it's relatively lightweight. It's carbon wood covered in rawhide, and it is designed with the comfort of the horse in mind, not the rider. Having said that, we ride all the time. I've had all kinds of saddles. I've gotten rid of everything except this saddle. It is absolutely wonderful. It's I liken it to liver. There's no middle of the road with liver. You either love it or you don't like it at all. And that's pretty much what these saddles are like. The saddle was designed to carry everything that a cavalry trooper needed for himself and for his mount. You'll see there's all kinds of slots and rings on here. It was designed to carry your blanket, your rain gear, the curry comb and brush for your horse and hoof pick, extra set of shoes, your carbine, half a tent, pretty much everything and anything you needed was carried on this saddle. And they were designed specifically for that. And again, this is my youngest son here, and that's pretty much the only saddle he rides.
This is the only saddle I'll ever ride for the rest of my life. It's extremely comfortable in my opinion, and it's comfortable for the horse. I don't know if you can really see from down there, but there's a slot in the middle of the saddle,
yep.
And that's
to keep the horse's back cool.
You keep the horse's back cool, and it conforms more to the body of the horse instead of having a really rigid saddle, so you can ride all day and have them comfortable.
Just a way to get around from one place to the other. Right, Louise? You old witch. Yeah, now you're coming.
Oh, of course, now she is.
She gets a little fired up. She wants to go, go, go. She's an ex-racehorse.
Okay.
So, she's still got that racehorse mentality. Get me up front. She hates being in the back.
She wants to be the lead horse.
Oh, absolutely. And the
monster shooting different. Around them.
Every horse is different.
This guy right here, I had gotten him probably 5 years ago. I brought him out to reenactment, started shooting off his back. No problem with it.
Right.
A horse I had before him, I brought him out to reenactment, started shooting. I thought I was going to go flying off. It all depends on the horse.
Just like dogs. We got two dogs. Yep. One's want to run to the gun, and the other want to run the other way hard
exactly.
As he can go. So, yeah, that answers that question.
It's a matter of exposure and getting used to it.
Yeah.
Some of them never take it.
Yeah,
some
never get
a thing.
You owned your horses.
In the Civil War, no, your horse was issued to you. If you were in Union cavalry, a Yankee, you were given a horse. The horse actually belonged to the U.S. government. If you were a Confederate cavalryman, you had to supply your own horse and equipment. And if your horse was shot or became lame or for any reason, if you were in the Union Army, they gave you another horse. Whatever you needed, they would give you.
Keeps the planes actually from going. What we do is use it to cut this tail off and then close the mouth. Back then, they had nitrated paper, so they just stuck it in there.
The enemy's still coming at you. They're getting, starting up that field. They're getting closer. Because they're going to wait till the fire's going, the fire's done, and they're going to move on.
Front rank, ready.
So officers can keep that up. They can keep doing that if they wish to do that. Now another way, if they see an aggressive enemy wanting to charge and take the ground that you're holding, the enemy will start charging. So what you try to do is deliver as much lead and as
so you had blacksmiths assigned to artillery units, and of course you had to have them assigned. You had to have blacksmiths assigned to cavalry units, once again using those traveling forges, because cavalry guys travel on horses, they fight on horses.
rifle right mark.
Isn't that much for you? Oh, yeah. The water in there?
Huh. These are bigger tents than the other ones. These tents are a lot bigger than those over there, aren't they?
Yeah.
For what reason?
They're pumping ones.
Okay, so they're on the move. This is more of a permanent...
Well, these are more like a permanent for like encampments, winter encampments.
Yeah.
That's where we would be in. They're over there, they're pump tents.
They have little stoves for these in the wintertime? No, wow.
But today,
yeah.
When we go camping in the wintertime, we have a little heater.
Yeah.
No, seriously.